Dear students, welcome to the digital classes. I am Bhavan Prakash, school student maths, working at ZPHS Vallabhi, Khamman district. Students, now we will discuss the third chapter, Elements of Geometry. We know that in our daily life, we can see the different types of constructions, different shapes of constructions. The construction of a building, the size and shape of the building includes that the plinth area, the breadth of the wall, the height of the wall, the size of the roof. All these includes the construction of a building. And in any construction, there are some geometric principles can be involved. In our daily life, we know that the geometry is widely used in paintings and handicrafts, laying of floor, designs, etc. We can say that our life without geometry is not imaginable. Students, the great constructions like Taj Mahal, Char Minar, and Great Wall of China, and Eiffel Tower, and the ancient temples in South India, and all these constructions are the best examples of application of geometry. So in this all the great constructions, there are some principles of geometry are involved. That's why they are very strengthened even today, because they are constructed a long back, even though they are very strong because of the involvement of principles of geometry. Now we will discuss the history of geometry. The word geometry is derived from Greek words geo and metrium. Here the geo means earth and metrium means measurement. This means earth and metrium means measurement. From these two Greek words, these are Greek words. From these two Greek words, geometrical knowledge of the Indus Valley civilization we found in the excavations of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro, where there is evidence of circle drawing instruments from as early as 2500 BC. The Swarupa Sutras in Vedic Sanskrit teach the roots of geometric principles involved in the construction of ritual fire altars. The amazing idea behind the construction of fire altars is that occupy same area, although they are in different shapes. In Swarupa Sutras, the simple Pythagorean triples are there, such as 3, 4, 5, and 5, 12, 13 etc. All these are in Sulabha Sutras.
Ancient
Euclid of Alexandria. He is the mathematician from Alexandria. He wrote a book, The Elements. The Elements of series of 13 books.
The Euclid created the first system of thought based on the fundamental definitions, axioms, and postulates and rules of inference through logic. So here we will discuss about the Euclid's Elements of Geometry.
Euclid's Elements of Geometry.
From the studies of space and solids in the space around them, an abstract geometrical notion of solid object was developed. A solid has shape, size, and position, and can be moved from one place to another place. Its boundaries are called surfaces.
So here Euclid derived a solid. So he said that it has a volume. It can be moved from one place to another place, and its boundaries are the surfaces. And they separate one part of the solid from another part.
The boundaries of surface are curves or straight lines. These lines end in points.
Here we said that here the edges of the solid is surface, and the edges of surface is the lines or curves, and the edges of the lines are points.
So whenever you can observe this diagram,
so this is the 3D diagram. So it has lines as edges. So it has three dimensions. They are length, breadth, and height. So if you remove the height, you will get surface. It has two dimensions, length and breadth. Wherever we remove the breadth, we will get a line. It has one dimension. If you remove the length from the line, we will get a point. It has no dimensions. So this is point. So here this is line, plane or surface. This is cube.
So Euclid said that these are the basic words or fundamental terms of geometry. And this cube, and that means solid.
Cube means here this is a solid. A solid
and surface or curved surface and lines and points. Euclid said that considered as fundamental terms of geometry. What are the fundamental terms? Fundamental terms of geometry are solids, surfaces, lines, and points. These are the fundamental terms of geometry. With the use of these terms, like line segment, angle, triangle are defined. So you could define point, line, and plane in book 1 of his Euclid's listed 23 definitions. Some of them are given here. So you could define point, line, and plane in the book 1 of elements. Euclid listed 23 definitions in this first book of elements. Now we will discuss, or we will list some of the definitions of 23 definitions. So the important definitions of book 1 from the elements, some important definitions are: the first definition, a point is that which has no path. First definition, a point which has no path, that which has no path. So it has no path, no length, no breadth. That means there is no dimension. And second, a line is breadthless length. Second one is, a line is breadthless length. Next, third one is, the end of the line are points. The end of the line are points. That means if you take a line like this, or line segment, so here the end is the point, here also end is the point. Next, the straight line is a line which lies evenly the points on itself. He said that the fourth definition is, the straight line is a line which lies evenly with the points on itself. The line is a line which lies evenly, which lies evenly with the points on itself. That means if you take a line like this here, this is the line, is the collection of points lies on itself. So if you take like all these points, it will be a line. So next one is, a surface is that which has length and breadth only. The surface is that which has length and breadth only.
Ratta. So if you take a surface like this, it has length and breadth only, the edges are the lines. So here said that the sixth one is the edges of a surface. We take a surface like this, the edges, these are the lines, here also a line. So the edges of surface are lines. The next one is the plane surface is a surface which lies evenly with the straight lines on itself. A plane surface is a surface which lies evenly with the straight lines on it. So if you take a surface here, all these are the straight lines like this. Evenly, all these are the straight lines. The surface made by all the straight lines. So these are the main and some of the important definitions which are derived. 23 definitions are derived by Euclid. These are the some important definitions. While defining the surface, here the term used area. What is the area? So it has length and breadth. So here, while defining the terms, we have to use other terms. The terms also you have to define. Like this, it can be extended. So that's why the mathematicians concluded that in any method, in any theorems, some undefined terms are there. We have to left for the some terms as undefined terms. Here also, in this geometry also, some undefined terms are there, because there is no need of define the terms, the line, point, like that. So in this geometry, some undefined terms also there. Terms are, what are the undefined terms? They are point, line, surface. These are the undefined terms according to Euclid. So Euclid used these definitions in assuming some geometric properties which need no proofs. These assumptions are self-evident truths. He divided them into two types. They are axioms and postulates. So while defining some definitions, the Euclid assuming some properties which are no need of proof. Those are the axioms and postulates. Axioms and postulates. Axioms are the statements which are not need to prove, which are to be truth. So what are the postulates? Postulates are like the same meaning of axiom, but axioms are the statements which are applicable in all areas of the mathematics, but postulates are the statements which are applicable for geometry. So axioms are the statements which are self-evident. Axioms are the statements which are self-evident. So here we will see one example. What is the axiom? The whole is always greater than the part. We know that there is no need of proof for this statement. So there is no need of proof. This type of statements are axioms. The axioms arise in different situations. So some of the Euclid axioms are here. So we will discuss Euclid axioms. So first one is, things which are equal to the same things are equal to one another. Things which are equal to the things which are equal to the same things are equal to one another. Equal to one another. That means things which are equal to the same thing are equal to one another. That means, for example, A is equal to P and A is equal to R. Here, the things which are equal to the same thing. Here, the same thing. A is equal to B, A is equal to R. Same thing, that means A, are equal to one another. Here, the things which are equal to the same thing, that means P and R. These are, this implies, you can say that P is equal to R. The things which are equal to the same thing, then these two things are equal. That is the first axiom of Euclid. Second, if equal are added to equals, the whole are also equal. If equals are added to equals, added to equals, the whole are also equal. So here, if equals are added to equal, the wholes are also equal. That means, if you take equals are added to equals, so if there are equals are there, if some equals, 10 equals are added to equal, these two are equal, so if we add, here also 3, here also 3. Equals are added to equals, you will get equal. So this is the second axiom. Third one, if equals are subtracted from equals, the remainder is also equal. Third one is, if equals are, if equals are subtracted from equals remainders are equal. So if you take two equals, for example, some numbers here, two equals are, if you subtract equals from these equals, that means if you subtract two here also two, you will get same value. So this is the third axiom. The equals, if equals are subtracted from equal, remainders are, the result values are equal. So next two axiom is, things which coincide with one another are equal to one another. Next one is, things which coincide one another are equal to one another. Equal to one another. Things which are coincide one another equal to one. That means if you take two line segments here, this is 5 centimeters, for example, here also 5 centimeters. If you put this line segment on this, they will be coincident because of their equal length. So if coincide these two line segments, then you can say that they are equal. So that is the meaning of coincide one another are equal to one another. Next one is, things which are double of the same things are equal to one another. Things which are double of, things which are, things which are double of same things are equal to one another. So here, things which are double of same things. For example, x, if you double this, it can be equal to some b. Here also same thing, which is double, it is equal to c. The things double of same things, if you double the x value, it will be b. And also, if you double the x, you will get c, then the b and c are equal. And next one is, things which are halves of the same things are equal to one another. Things which are halves of the same thing are equal to one another. Are equal to one another. Is which are halves of some same thing are equal to one another. These are the Euclid axioms. Now we will discuss Euclid's 5 postulates. So first one is, there is a unique line that passes through the given two distinct points. There is a unique line that passes through the given two distinct lines. there is a unit line passes through distinct point. So this is the Euclid's postulate. So if you take two points P and Q, if you draw a line through these two points, we can draw like this. If you try to draw another line through these two points, is it possible? Let us see. If you start from here, draw a line through P, it can be like this. If you start here through the P, it can be drawn like this. You can't draw through the Q. If you start here, it can be go this side. So here also, if you draw like this, it cannot be draw through the P. So only one line. So if you draw like this, if only one line can be drawn through the these two points, that means there is a unique line passes through distinct points. So this is the first postulate. Second one is, a line segment can be extended on either side to form a straight line. Second one is, a line segment can be extended on either side to form a straight line. So that means if you take a line segment AB, so if you extend a line behind point B and also here also you extend this side, it can be like extended like this. So here these two sides, if you extend the both sides, has no end points. There is no end point here also, no end point. That means this is a line. If it has end points, this is the line segment. If you extend these both sides, you will get no end points. That's why this is a line. So a line segment can be extended on either side, form a straight line. So now we will discuss about third postulate. Third postulate is, we can describe a circle with any center and radius. We can describe a circle with center and radius. What does it mean? Here, if you want to draw a circle, what are the measurements do you need? So you need center and some radius. So if you have given radius of 3 cm to draw a circle, so you need a center where it can be the center is some given point is there, then you take a some radius 2 centimeters, then you can draw a circle. So no other measurements required. So only one measurement is there required for the circle. If you give any one measurement, you can draw a circle. So and also you need a center. So if you give a radius 3 centimeters and center is some point B, here some O, we can simply draw a circle with this radius. So like that, whenever you want to draw a circle, you need center and radius. So these two are the enough to draw a circle. So next one is all rectangles are equal to one another. All right angles are equal to one another. Okay, now we will discuss fourth postulate, that is the all right angles are equal to one another. So if you draw a right angles like this, and cut them along the arms and place on angles one above other, we can observe that they are all coincident. That means they are equal. So all the right angles are equal to one another. This is the fourth postulate of Euclid. Now we discuss the fifth postulate. So if you take two lines and take this line, a line falling on two lines means this L M N. A line falling on these two lines. If you produce these two lines, both sides, these two lines meet the side which the sum of two angles are less than 180. That means less than two right angles. Here, this side, sum of these two right angles, sum of these two angles is less than 180 degrees. Here, sum of these two interior angles is greater than 180 degrees. If you extend these two lines, both sides, these two lines can be meet which side? The side where the sum of interior angles is less than two right angles, then this side can be meet these two lines. This is the meaning of the fifth postulate. Some other mathematicians are given some postulates which are equal to the fifth postulate. The equal postulates are, first one is through a point not on given line, exactly one parallel line may be drawn to the given line. This is the postulate given by John Playfair. This postulate is, through a point not on a given line, through a point not on a given line, exactly one parallel line may be drawn to the given line. Exactly one parallel line can be drawn to the given line. So So this postulate, which is equal to the Euclidean fifth postulate, this is given by John Playfair. So this means throw a point not on a given line. That means a line is there, L, a point which is on the not which is not on given line. So here not on given line. So this is given. So this postulate says that from this, through this point, only one parallel line to the given line. Only one parallel line can be drawn. If you draw infinitely from this line, if you draw like this, lines are infinitely you can draw. So from all these infinity lines, only one line can be draw, which is parallel to given line. So this is the equivalent postulate to the Euclidean fifth postulate given by Playfair. Another Legendre's postulate is there. Legendre's postulate is the sum of angles of any triangle is. Legendre's postulate says the sum of angles of any triangle is constant and is equal to two right angles. Constant and equal to two right angles. So this is the postulate given by Legendre. So here sum of angles of any triangle, if you take a triangle like this, here angle 1, angle 2, angle 3, this postulate says that sum of angles, these three angles, angle 1 plus angle 2 plus angle 3 is equal to two right angles, that means 180 degrees. This is given by Legendre. Another postulate is there, that is there exists a pair of lines everywhere equidistant from one another. In everywhere there are a pair of lines are exist. If a line exists here, another line also exists here, which is equidistant from this. This is M, this is M, so equidistant from this. If you take a line here, There exists another line which is equidistant from N. This is B. So if you take a line N, there exists a line which is P, which equidistant from N. If you take any line, there can be exist another line which is equidistant from this line. This is a postulate. Other postulate is there, that is if a straight line intersects any one of two parallel lines, if a straight line intersects any one of two parallel lines, any one of two parallel lines, any one of two parallel lines, then it will intersect to other also.
Then it will intersect other also. That means a pair of parallel lines are there. If you take a pair of parallel lines, a line is there which is intersect the one line, then surely it can be intersect other also.
So that is the meaning of this postulate. Okay students, these are the Euclidean postulates, and equal to the fifth postulate, some postulates are given by some mathematicians which are discussed now. So now we will do some examples which are based on these given postulates.